Hello, thank you for coming. Welcome to the Claremont Institute panels on conservatism in the Trump era. I'm moderating the first panel, which is up here, on recovering American conservatism. I'm Michael Pack, president of the Claremont Institute. And before I start, I'd like to thank the people at the Claremont Institute who put this marvelous event together, especially Amanda Kalman and her staff. Thank you very much. A lot of hard work. Thank you. Lots of hard work goes into it, and it's all behind the scenes, often underappreciated, but we appreciate it. Most of you know the Claremont Institute, but for the very few who do not, our mission is to restore the principles of the American founding to their rightful and preeminent authority in American life. I think a lot of that will be exhibited today. We have three main programs. We have the Claremont Review of Books, a distinguished quarterly, and our great editor-in-chief, Charles Kesler, is here. And I'm pretty confident most of you are subscribers, but if not, please subscribe. And we have CRB Digital, where we have some online original content as well as the CRB articles. We have a law center, the Center for Constitutional Jurisprudence, which litigates and prepares amicus briefs on constitutional principles. And we have fellowship programs, 3 1- and 2-week quick surveys of American political thought out in lovely Newport Beach every summer. And one is for recent college graduates, the Publius program. One is the Lincoln program for people in mid-career. And one is for law students, the Marshall program. We have, I think, some fellows in the audience. Would they all rise, the former fellows, alumni? Is there anyone out there? I know a few. Thank you. And Dr. Kesler as well, but you don't have to rise, Charles. They are a great group. We've been doing this since 1980. Many of them are in D.C. in positions of responsibility and authority at think tanks, universities, media, and now some in the Trump administration, and hopefully keeping the country within constitutional principles and a return to the founding. We have recently opened, the Claremont Institute has, a D.C. office, and is in part to provide events for these alumni, but also public events like this one. So I hope those of you that are new to the Claremont Institute will continue to go to our events. If you're not on our mailing list, talk to Amanda and make sure that you are. They are all fabulous events, as you will see tonight. For this first panel, each panelist is going to speak for about 7 minutes, and we hope there's plenty of time for Q&A, because I'm confident this audience will have a lot to say. And I will read their intros in the order in which they're going to speak. We've kept the intros very brief, so there's more time for them to speak and more time for Q&A. They will speak each from the podium, and then they'll be seated, and we'll take Q&A directly from the audience. The first to speak is Mark Bauerlein. He is a professor of English at Emory University, senior editor of First Things Journal, and a contributor to the Claremont Review of Books. He is the author of The Dumbest Generation, How the Digital Age Stupefies Young Americans and Jeopardizes Our Future. Mark has taught at Emory since 1989, only briefly taking a break in 2003 to 2005 to serve as the director of the Office of Research and Analysis at the National Endowment for the Arts. Next is Michael Uhlmann. He is a senior fellow and faculty member of the Claremont Institute and a visiting professor of political science at Claremont Graduate University. Prior to teaching at Claremont, he was a senior fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center, vice president for public policy research at the Bradley Foundation, and professor of law at George Mason University Law School. Chrisopher Caldwell is a senior editor at the Weekly Standard and frequent contributor to the Claremont Review of Books. He is the author of Reflections on the Revolution in Europe, Immigration, Islam, and the West. Finally, Dr. Charles Kesler is the editor of the Claremont Review of Books and senior fellow of the Claremont Institute. He is also a distinguished professor of government at Claremont McKenna College. He has written extensively on American constitutionalism and political thought, and his edition of the Federalist Papers is the best-selling edition in the country, and the best, it's fair to say. Okay, so let me hand it off to you first.
Shame. will be brief. I like the format, actually, five to seven minutes. For my take, where I work on college campuses and in the magazine publishing world, I saw Donald Trump early on as something of a liberation for conservatism, and one that I saw creating among many conservatives a lot of trepidation. And the trepidation had to do with the fact that, Donald Trump is not a principled conservative. He just doesn't seem to consider those categories all that important. But what he did do very early on, and this is one of the things that sparked his campaign so much, was that he violated some profound taboos that have become so entrenched in at least the parts of culture and society dominated by liberals and progressives, including education, higher and lower education, the art world, the publishing world, certainly the media, and the advocacy world for different progressivist groups, these taboos are very powerful. And he came out and said one thing after another that broke the rules. And so much that the news that night, everyone was saying, it's over, he's done. And the next day he was just back. I mean, the most prominent case was that second debate when he went up on stage and he carried through. And he did not lose. And the lesson here was that one could say things that cross, for instance, the taboo that one can say all lives matter. I mean, look what happened to Martin Malloy when he said all lives matter. Boy, did they take him down? Trump did it, and he insisted on it over and over again. He wasn't going to break down the lives matter into different racial groups. You just don't do that. Okay? I mean, you do that in my world. And forget it. Your career is over. The wall broke taboos about globalization and multiculturalism, and it was so blunt the way in which he did this that it left many people sputtering in exasperation. I mean, where I am at Emory, you may have seen it was a bad year for Emory last year because of a couple of the Trump issues that came up. Someone did the chalk drawings, and a group of 50 students went nuts the next day and hounded the president's office, asking him to do something about it. Track these people down. Trump 2016. That's what they wrote, and the students were apoplectic. But that shows this was not something that affected them at the level of principle, or of politics, or certainly of policy. Right? It went deeper down than that, and that's why we should understand this in terms of taboo, in terms of saying something that isn't just wrong, it's outrageous, something that isn't just misconstrued, it's abominable. And after Trump won, the emails in my department, my goodness, talking about the return of white supremacy, they held forums, my department hosted campus forums, people could come in and they could voice their dismay, it was these group therapy sessions that they were doing, and you just thought these people are unhinged. But again, this touches on very profound human commitments and loyalties, especially with these particular taboos about guilt, right? Guilt, fundamental sense of white guilt, of American guilt, of male guilt, of Christian guilt. These are very powerful weapons in the progressivist agenda. And they have had many, many conservative leaders, Republican figures, intimidated for a long, long time. That's why I call this a liberation for Trump. He said it, and he won. And he won. And it's just sort of many of them still standing in disbelief, not knowing what to do. And the blunt nature of Trump, attacking these things. I remember one line he said, it felt so good. I am so sick and tired of this politically correct crap. That's how he put it, right? And a lot of people said, you know, come on, let's elevate the discourse, let's raise it. No, you do not combat a damaging taboo with reasoning, with arguments, with evidence. You have to use other tools. You have to make fun of it. Make jokes. Use humor. Use exasperation. And that, and if you can carry it off, that's how you overcome the taboo. And I think that's what people in Trump's in Trump's first rallies responded to so much. Okay, they were having a great time, and it was the first time in a long time so many of them had attended a political gathering and found that the unscripted free-for-all of the Trump hour and 20-minute speech was, again, a release for many of them. Now, the question is, for conservatism in the Trump era, I think the Republican leaders look at this and they have to make a calculation. It worked on the national level for Trump to challenge these taboos in the way he did. Will this work in my district? Is this a political winner in my state? Because I think most of them share the impatience with many of these taboos, and they recognize these are very damaging things that are hurting our civic sphere very much, and they've got to stop. So we'll see. We'll see what they do.
Well, I wish to announce that brothers Bauerlein, Caldwell, and Kesler have all yielded their time to me, so I'll be taking a half hour or so of your time, followed by a quiz. So, well, it's good to be here, and let me cut to the chase immediately. I want to talk a little bit about governing rather than getting elected. I think this is a serious problem for President Trump. His election certified, if not the demise, then certainly the necessity for a radical reconfiguration of the conservative movement. It was a long time coming. It could have been done by other means, but Trump certainly did it. What's going to happen in that reconfiguration isn't immediately clear, but great minds are working on it, some of them even in Claremont, some here in Washington, others elsewhere. It's going to have to get redone. The times, to quote a recent Nobel laureate, they are a-changing. It was time for the, it's the only time I'll quote him, by the way. It's necessary for the movement to reconfigure itself in some intelligent way. And Trump, I don't think, God bless him, is going to be the champion of this new movement. Could be. But not, I think, in the way that Ronald Reagan was the champion of the older movement. But let us see. In fairness to Mr. Trump, and I should say that the future of the conservative movement is for the time being tied to him. So his fate will in part determine the fate of the revivified conservative movement, I think. So let's hope the marriage continues to work. In fairness to President Trump, the circumstances in 1980 are radically different from what they were now, and that's worth talking a little bit about. The deficit was, the national debt was $1 trillion, is now 20. There was a rough kind of Cold War consensus on foreign policy. The Democratic Party hadn't yet gone completely bonkers. It would proceed to do so with great acceleration over the next 20 years. But it is now a part, almost an anti-American party, certainly a party that believes in the continued and sustained weakness of their own country. The culture, more importantly, was still wounded. It was wounded, but still moderately healthy. It would be possible, it was possible, having had a hand in some of this, for Ronald Reagan to speak about family, church, motherhood, God, and home without embarrassment and be applauded by audiences. All of those concepts are now in some radical doubt, except before conservative audiences. The speed with which the culture has deteriorated, I think, is one of the extraordinary and disastrous phenomena of our time. putting it back together will not be easy. Culture precedes politics, and any conservative movement that doesn't address the cultural abyss that now confronts the country will not have much to say about the way the future works. Politics alone cannot address this issue. It's on my mind. I remarked to Chrisopher a few moments ago. Just last week he published a piece in First Things, which I enjoin all of you to write, on the new drug problem affecting working class and lower mid Americans. We didn't have to face that in 1980, but we do now, and its ramifications are extraordinary, as Chrisopher points out at eloquent length. I don't think Mr. Trump is going to be able to do much about the cultural phenomenon, but he can make a start at some other things that will make it possible for a successor in office to begin to put the culture and the politics of the regime back together. He's made a reasonably good start on immigration. In fact, even without redoing the wall, it's already had a useful effect. And so it's the metaphoric wall that matters, I think. And I would just as soon keep it that way. Rather than a lot of bricks and mortars, though one of my colleagues, an economist, says we should make the wall into a jobs program, and then we could sell it to the Democrats. We'll make the walls 4 feet deep, build it from both sides, and have movies, and you can make it into a first-class jobs program. Might work. But it's a start on immigration, and I think that's important. Everything else, by and large, is in play and yet to be determined. Don't call your bookie yet on health care. Don't call your bookie yet on tax reform. Don't call them on any other major piece of legislation. This administration is now confronting the dark reality of life in Washington, which is to say a regime in which Congress no longer acts as a legislature, in which all power willy-nilly has been vested by delegation on the part of Congress, and deference on the part of the courts to a bunch of bureaucrats in the executive branch, the control of which is exceedingly difficult even for a dedicated and disciplined White House, one of which this administration does not yet have. I don't know a lot about larger questions of governing. I know a fair amount about White Houses and how they should be governed and not. This is, I'm afraid to say, an accident waiting to happen. There are four and perhaps five centers of competing power inside this White House. That's an unnatural act, and it's not going to have a happy ending. How exactly it gets sorted out, I do not know, but it's going to be a mess. And I think it's a measure, with all due respect, of Mr. Trump's naivete about how Washington works. He'd better get that White House act together. Personnel office in general, for example, is way behind the curve on this. I know of departments in which there are two and three only political appointees 2.5 months into the administration. That's a disaster. And you could combine that with the chaos inside the White House. It's going to compound the felony. The difficulty is, in modern American politics, presidents have a honeymoon period of about a year, year and a half, to get much done. Their political capital runs down very swiftly in that period. He doesn't have a lot of time. If they don't get some major measures through in this year, my guess would be Congress will lose interest in the White House, and they have to run for re-election next year. Mitch McConnell is worried about expanding his Senate hold. He has an opportunity here to pick up a half a dozen seats in the Senate. He's not going to be blind to that. There's an upper level on how much money, political price, he's going to pay to run that risk. The House could also be in play in ways that it hasn't been, in no small part because for the first time in American history, a former president has set up a major political operation, which he's running from the city of Washington with the help of diverse outside billionaires and so on. They're not going to quit. They're going to take every dirty, rotten, cheap advantage of the smallest mistake. And God knows with the larger mistakes that this administration makes. Now, having said that, let me give you a little bit of good news. All right? The cabinet, I think, on the whole, is excellent, better than I would have thought. But the members of the cabinet need help, and they can't do it alone. They have to get serious about governing in the sense of lining their priorities up. The It's going to take more than bumper strip slogans. God knows more than Twitters. And I hereby appoint myself a committee of one to banish the Twitter from the presidential household. Good luck with that. It makes the president look petty and juvenile. The issues that he addressed in the campaign are grave, and they deserve more intelligent and more sophisticated and politically damaging treatment than what you can do by means of a Twitter. And if he continues that, he's going to injure himself, I think, very severely. But there's lots of work to be done, and lots of intelligent work to be done. I think the National Security Council is in good hands. The White House Counsel's Office is in excellent hands, well-staffed. They don't have a lot on the policy front yet in the White House. Mr. Cohn, surprisingly, the former Goldman partner in the National Economic Council, is actually running domestic policy and appears to be doing a reasonably good job of it. But a lot of people don't know this, and it's yet to be determined how it's going to come out. But if I had to give one piece of advice to the president at this point, bureaucratically, get the White House to act together, have a genuine chief of staff, organize it more or less pyramidally with some flexibility in the joints. You cannot have four or five centers of power competing for your time and attention. There has to be an organized and disciplined message to be carried out vis-a-vis Congress, vis-a-vis the public at large, and vis-a-vis the interest groups who can bring you down and will spend a lot of time trying to do so. Shorten the agenda. One of the great lessons of Ronald Reagan's discipline was to keep it short and stupid. He came into office with about three things he wanted to do: bring the Soviet Union to its knees, do something about excessive regulation, do something about taxes and spending. He did all three, by and large. Nothing is permanent in this world, but by keeping his agenda to three items, he was able to accomplish a large part of each of them. Trump has an agenda of about 10 items, most of which he thinks he can cure by the issuance of executive orders. Ain't gonna happen. Better to concentrate on two or three, get them done, and go out and sell them emphatically, and not just by means of tweets. Governing is quite different from campaigning, and you can't govern by means of bumper strips and slogans. He's going to have to learn that, or he's going to lose his mission. Keep it short, keep it simple, keep it easily communicated, and succeed. And he's got about a year to do it, and I think he can do it. We have to help him do it. Thank you.
Hello. All right. Thanks for having me. We're here to talk about recovering conservatism. The implication is that someone has fumbled it, and so we're trying to recover it. I think in order to do that, we need to figure out what conservatism is, what we're talking about, because I think that often, especially in a room like this where you get people who talk about conservatism all the time, you have many different definitions of it. Very often, when we talk about recovering or reinvigorating conservatism, we are actually looking for a more purposeful sounding or more noble sounding or less opportunistic sounding way of like dressing up basically the fortunes of the Republican Party. But I think that there is something that there is a conservatism that is distinct from the Republican Party. In fact, so much so that I think the problem is that conservatism over the past 30 years has grown really distinct from the Republican Party. I think we do well to remember that the purpose of conservatism is to conserve. And there's something very special about American conservatism. When you ask yourself the question, why conserve? There's a kind of a classic answer that we get mostly from Europe. And it takes many different forms. You know, you talk about this is the way you write a sonnet. This is the form of a sonnet. Petrarch did it this way. Shakespeare did it this way. If you do it this way, you can write a really beautiful poem. You can talk about religion. This is the order of the universe, which creates the order of society, which creates an order that you ought to live with in your own life. And I mean, you can try and wing that in the, you know, 70 that you have left to you, but you'd probably be better off doing it the way we've been doing it for the last 2,000 years. And that's what conservatism basically is in the core of our tradition. What's confusing, I think, is that American political conservatism, I would argue, is something quite different. I mean, it draws on those things, it admires those things. That European core of conservatism is what created the things we treasure. But I think the key reason that you'd have conservatism in a democracy is kind of epistemological. Democracy is a very strange system. You have people of quite modest endowments and modest educational attainments making decisions. And you have to find a way to make that okay. In most societies, that's not okay. You have average people making decisions and the thing will blow up. It's conservatism that makes it possible to have democracy. I mean, it's imperative to our survival. When you have modest people making decisions, you have to remember that for most people, wisdom comes really slowly. It comes because it comes along with familiarity. It takes years to acquire it. And if you don't remain in the same place and look at things the same way enough to acquire that wisdom, you wind up deciding based on your whims and your urges, and that's what people do in the state of nature, and it gets them into trouble. So what basically happens is if things aren't conserved and if things don't remain the same, then the people lose the claim to rule. They lose the competence to rule, and so the legitimacy of having the people rule gets pulled out from under them like a rug. And so, if you can get the society, if a malevolent leader, let us say, can get the society changing fast enough, he can totally delegitimize the idea of democracy. And that's why I would say that in a democracy, people have a right to have things not change. I would say a categorical right. Or let me put it this way, in a democracy, no one has a right to anything, you know, of that sort. People have a right to assert their wish in their line of in their line of life to have things not change. And that, I think, is the thing that we've lost over the last few decades. And I think that we have to face the paradoxical way in which the man who's considered the hero of conservatism, Ronald Reagan, laid the groundwork for that overly rapid change, because in many respects, the free market is not a conservative institution. And many of these freedoms that we have are not conservative. They bring change, and with change come threats to our self-rule. I think that's about enough out of me, but I will say that one of the things that is being reasserted now, and I think that its fate is really up in the air, is this right to say, I don't want things to change because I don't want things to change. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Ladies and gentlemen, spring break in Washington. It seemed like a wonderful idea. And we sort of dodged the storm, so I don't regret it. But it didn't turn out quite the way we had planned, and that may be the case with the Trump administration as well. We'll see. The question I want to raise directly is, what kind of conservative is President Trump? He must, in my view, be some kind of conservative, because liberals in government, Hollywood, and the media have poured on him the kind of vitriol they do not reserve for moderates or ideological nobodies. Inside the Beltway, many famous conservatives have joined in the sport, but for opposite reasons. Trump, they allege, is no conservative at all, but a populist, perhaps a demagogue, out to discredit and destroy, in fact, the conservative movement. And so they tweet and retweet, "Nevermore." In his three major public speeches so far, his remarks at the Republican National Convention, his inaugural address, and his speech to the joint session of Congress, President Trump did not mention conservatism at all. The word never escaped his lips, nor the adjective even. Even at CPAC, the Conservative Political Action Conference, he mentioned conservatism exactly once, claiming simply and almost in passing that his election was a victory for, quote, conservative values, unquote. What those were, he did not, what those values were, he did not specify, except to say that Americans believe in, quote, freedom, security, and the rule of law, unquote, and in standing up for America, for American workers, and the American flag. Now, Mr. Trump is the kind of conservative president whom one expects to say, proudly and often, the chief business of the American people is business. Calvin Coolidge, of course, got there first. But Trump shows increasing signs, I would submit, of thinking along broadly Coolidgean lines and of redirecting the GOP toward its roots, surprisingly, in the pre-New Deal, pre-Cold War party of William McKinley and Calvin Coolidge. Let me make this argument for you. In his speech to Congress, which drew so many favorable reviews, Trump promised that his administration would open, quote, a new chapter of American greatness, unquote. But he couldn't do so without saying something about the preceding chapters. And it's his elaboration of these that gave rise to the new tone that critics often detected in the speech. For the first time, President Trump put his presidency in historical context, as it were, emphasizing that the country is approaching its 250th anniversary, 9 years away, that is, as measured from the Declaration of Independence. To stand up for America, he seems to be saying, is thus to stand up in some sense for the Declaration of Independence. And hence his invocation in this speech to Congress of Black History Month and of our nation's path towards civil rights, both of which he acknowledged in the first paragraph, seems something weightier than throwaway lines. In the speech, he praised two presidents. He doesn't usually mention any of his successors or his predecessors, but he mentioned here Lincoln and Dwight Eisenhower, and he recalled the wondrous inventions, the telephone, the typewriter, the automatic telegraph, unveiled at the nation's 100th anniversary celebrations, inventions that made the modern media his bete noire possible, one might mention. On the basis of this common heritage, he called at least five times for bipartisanship, a word that had not escaped his lips in the campaign, and for confidence in the American future. There are many clues, I think, to the kind of conservatism that Trump embraces in this most recent speech. Now, to echo some comments already made by my wise colleagues, Now, Trump is not and never was a movement conservative. Apart from a youthful flirtation with Ayn Rand, is there any other kind? He has displayed no patience for libertarianism, traditionalism, neoconservatism, or the other endangered species that the movement has sought to conserve for many decades. Don't forget, he told George Stephanopoulos on ABC during the campaign, this is called the Republican Party. It's not called the Conservative Party. That was Trump during the campaign. Trump raised glancingly the possibility that conservatism ought to be measured by the standards of republicanism, or at least ought to be defined in conjunction with the GOP's principles and history, rather than mostly the other way around. And as I suggested, Trump's policies suggest that his own brand of conservatism comes close to the principles and agenda of the old Republican Party, which reached its peak in the 1920s. In those days, the GOP stood for high protective tariffs, for immigration tied to assimilation, or what Teddy Roosevelt called Americanization. The party was pledged to activist judges prepared to strike down state and sometimes federal laws encroaching on constitutional limitations. The usual conservative habit of the last couple of decades has been, of course, to stand for restraint, a kind of undifferentiated judicial restraint. The old party had a very different view of that. The old party stood for tax cuts, for internal improvements, or infrastructure spending, as we would call it today, and for a firm but restrained foreign policy tailored to the defense of national honor and interests. And aren't these the main elements of the Trump administration's policies? Now, I'm not proposing that he set out consciously to return the GOP to its historical roots. It's more likely that his own independent reading of our situation led him to similar conclusions and to similar ways of thinking. The breadcrumbs he dropped when addressing the joint session point in this direction. Trump quoted a well-known statement in that address of Congressman Abraham Lincoln that, quote, the abandonment of the protective policy will produce want and ruin among our people, unquote. Lincoln was a great protectionist before he became the great emancipator. But Trump could have as easily quoted McKinley's 1896 platform, protection, quote, is the bulwark of American industrial independence and the foundation of American development and prosperity, unquote. Or he could have quoted Coolidge's in 1924. Trump praised Eisenhower not for any achievement in foreign policy, for example, but for building, quote, the last truly great national infrastructure program, unquote. That is the interstate highway system. Now, the old Republican Party stretched from Lincoln to Herbert Hoover and continued to influence Eisenhower and Nixon. It dominated national politics to an extent that the modern conservative GOP, forged during the Cold War, could only dream of. Between Lincoln's election in 1860 and Hoover's loss to Roosevelt in 1932, Franklin Roosevelt, the GOP elected every president in a 72-year period. They elected every president but two, Grover Cleveland and Woodrow Wilson. They controlled both houses of Congress for 46 or so of the 72 years. Those halcyon days coincided with a determined embrace of Trump-like policies, or at least many Trump-like policies. Of course, it helped that the Democrats spent those decades living down their shameful support of slavery, secession, and Jim Crow. Yet, President Trump can't simply ignore the modern conservative movement. For one thing, its two great successes, victory in the Cold War and reigniting economic growth, have made plausible his own visions of post-Cold War foreign policy and of a resurgent economy. After those successes, however, modern conservatism mostly marked time and dreamed of limiting government. It had vain imaginings of how to build a conservative majority in the electorate, but nothing more. Trump offers a way out of the conservative stalemate, I think, a way forward to electoral success that begins with a kind of return to former Republican policies on immigration, infrastructure, protection, and more, which, among other things, allows us to connect to millions of working and middle-class voters previously ill-disposed to us. Now, I understand that America today is in many respects a very different country from what it was in the 1920s or the late 19th century when Republicans ruled. So the Trump administration's policies will have to be a mixture of old and new. On foreign policy in particular, he may go a different way than the Republicans of the 1920s and before. That remains to be seen. He stubbornly refuses to confirm my theory of his incipient Coolidgeism by insisting that Andrew Jackson is his favorite president. This is grist for Walter Russell Mead's mill. And he's had Jackson's portrait placed in the Oval Office, and he just came back from Nashville, Tennessee, where he visited the Hermitage, Andrew Jackson's house. And concerning Andrew Jackson, President Trump has uttered a ringing endorsement of support, which I will now quote in full. "I'm a fan." The slightly longer version goes like this. "They say that his campaign and his whole thing was most like mine. That was interesting." So I think the reality of Trump may not conform entirely to my theory, but I think that Trump himself and his personality and perhaps his executive style do obviously have something, or at least he believes, something in common with Andrew Jackson's. There's something to that, I think. You can't ignore it. On the other hand, you might say the broad direction of his policies is not Jacksonian in this sense. The broad direction of his policies is eerily familiar to anyone who's a student of the history of the Republican Party. It was the formula for Republican Party success, more or less, for many generations in our history. Let me end simply by saying one last note on this, on the differences between now and then. Above all, President Trump faces at least three challenges that the old Republicans did not have to confront. There is a politically correct establishment, in many ways the antithesis of liberal culture, in the universities, government, and the media, that has zero tolerance for his administration and his being. He has to find a way around or through them. In addition, what Stephen Bannon calls the deconstruction of the administrative state grows more necessary and more difficult every year. Finally, in a country in which about 40% of children are born out of wedlock, and in which the vast majority of federal spending every year is labeled insouciantly uncontrollable, the people's capacity to govern themselves seems to be in long-term decline. We seem to be in danger, as the first Republican president put it, of blowing out the moral lights around us. Thank you.
Well, thank you all. Very fascinating talks. I guess I will take the privilege of being MC and ask the first question. This is something I've asked Charles before, but if Trump is a pre-New Deal Republican, is he more Coolidge or is he more TR? You have compared him at one time or another to both, and that goes to the question of limited government. I mean, is he going to behave within constitutional limits or not? Is he going to be an activist within the Constitution or blow through those limits? And a second related question is, even if it is a way for electoral victory, to what extent are we comfortable giving up such a core modern conservative belief as free markets? I mean, not just protectionism, but that principle overall, interfering with individual companies as well as protectionism. To what extent is it possible for us, as we think of the future of conservatism, to turn our back on that? So let me ask that to Charles and anyone else who wants to comment.
Well, the first question, those are two good questions. The first one was about Teddy Roosevelt. And it's true, of course, you can't really talk about the pre-New Deal, pre-Cold War Republican Party without talking about Roosevelt. Now, as you know, TR went off on a kind of bender in 1912 and left the Republican Party and many of his friends. Partly over issues of direct democracy and his novel theory of executive power, which would give to the president a kind of Obama-esque whip hand over the other branches. In other ways, in foreign policy, I think TR was more of a traditionalist and more of an American, a typical American statesman, wise American statesman. But yes, there is, you know, he is, I guess TR was another New Yorker president. Trump might look at him and find some inspiration there, but so far he has not. I think there is, I did predict once in writing in the CRB that there was a certain potential for Trump to discover Teddy Roosevelt somewhere down the line. But instead he found Jackson, so I'm not sure you need both of them, you know? If you want to be a disruptive president, I don't think you may not need both of them. The other good question was about the free market. And yes, I don't think that it would be possible under modern conditions to return to as great an extent of protection or protectionism as the old Republican Party practiced. That's simply impossible for a number of reasons. And Trump always says that he, of course, is in favor of free markets, as the old Republican Party said too. This was an exception to the general preference for free market arrangements, but it was a very important exception for them. For one thing, you know, it's hard to remember, of course, but in those days, before the income tax, the great majority of revenues to run the government came from the tariff. So you had to have high tariffs if you were going to have, an active government, if you're going to have a national government that was doing things. And for us, alas, I don't think there's enough money. We have the income tax, and we don't want to uncover another main stream revenue for the federal government. We wouldn't want protectionism to reach those heights.
Are we going to bring a mic? Mike, yes, here comes a mic.
Thank you, Michael. I want to pick up on your comments, Charles, which I thought were quite perceptive. However, I want to raise a question. You suggested that Trump may be attempting to return us to the Lincoln to Hoover era, which could be described perhaps as a managed economy. I'm wondering how possible that is in the post-New Deal and post-Great Society world, the modern welfare state, which is a state that increasingly encourages dependence on the government. In fact, the last administration took it upon itself to do just that, because that is their key to their continued power. So we have, in a sense, a world today in which half the people or more, yes, more when we take the people who are in the academic world, are dependent on government in one way or another. And it encourages a kind of Hobbesian war of all against all. And so I'm wondering how realistic it is that this pre-Hoover and earlier agenda, this project, if you will, can be revived in this context whereby we have debts that are utterly out of control, unfunded liabilities, far in excess of the debts, and so forth.
No, that was, you correctly raised some of the differences between our situation and their situation in the 1920s or before. And I alluded to this at the end of my remarks as well. There's a kind of cultural decline that has set in. I don't think it necessarily irreversible, but it is deep-seated, and it would be very hard to reverse. And that is a legacy which fuels the welfare state, and the welfare state fuels it in turn. That will be very difficult to unwind on any governmental approach, I think. But Trump does have, it seems to me, the possibility of not simply of electorally revivifying the party for a while, but of ideologically rehabilitating it as well. In this sense, what he calls America first, I think would actually better be called Americans first. What he's talking about is actually thinking of Americans as the sovereign masters of their own country, who must be consulted in its government, and not the subjects of governmental power or in governmental benevolence. Recovering that idea, which is really at the heart of American constitutionalism, is not really populism. I'm not really sure that populism is the right term for what Trump is up to. The consent of the governed is part of constitutional democracy. It's not necessarily populist. I mean, it is a form of popular authority being exercised. But that could lead to, in the direction of a conservatism that is liberated from the kind of ideological debates that have grown stale over many decades, and lead it back into a directly and positively American form of conservatism. What we would be trying to conserve is the American constitutional system and its moral political presuppositions. That frees us from worrying so much about Burkean, extended Burkean considerations, as well as extended libertarian considerations of a certain kind, and it focuses our mind on the problem here and now, which is our increasing inability to govern ourselves. That is a hopeful sign. I mean, I'm certainly not here to explain why it will be so easy for the Trump administration to succeed in its endeavors. But I think that one can see a reasonable line of policy, of conservative policy, opening up that is neither traditionalist or libertarian, but sort of American. If he minds that vein, this could be a very interesting administration.
May I comment?
Yes.
Until Charles got to the last paragraph of his remarks, I wondered what land we were in. His last paragraph captured the sense of it, and now Charles is on both sides of this thing. He's perfectly balanced to be able to work out whatever happens under Trump or not. But part of the problem is that Trump himself is, look, if there's a book or an essay touching history, politics, culture, that has influenced Donald Trump's life. We have yet to hear its title. Right? And he doesn't have to be a deep dish intellectual. It may be even it's a virtue that he isn't. Neither was Ronald Reagan, but he read things, and he had opinions that were formed by what he read, and he wrote things that reshaped the opinions he possessed. I'm not sure about Trump, and my bottom line on Trump is I don't think we have a clue. Campaigning and governing are different. What he did in the campaign was, in its own way, brilliant, but it consisted largely of bumper strips and appeals, some of them overdue and worthwhile and patriotic, to segments of the public that had been left out and abandoned and needed to be brought back in. And I give him full marks for that. But if you look at the practical problems facing the country, $20 trillion debt, a GDP that hasn't reached 3% in I don't know how many years, and may not under Trump, a budget that is large parts of which are debt on arrival. Well, welcome to modern budgeting. I hope he gets a large part of his cuts and hope he gets his defense increases, but I wouldn't take that any of that to any bank. He doesn't want to touch entitlements. Good luck on the health care reform. There's 100 different ways you can reskin that cat. Something I hope good will come out, but I'm not sure. Ditto with the tax bill if we get there. The one part I meant to mention, he's done very well conceptually, I think, and that's regulatory reform. He's got the right people around him to do this. What he's proposed, I think, is A1. It really is excellent if they carry through on it, full marks. But politically, that's not sexy stuff. It's good, it's useful, overdue, necessary, and more power to him. Finally, on the courts, Gorsuch is a brilliant appointment. I'm glad he did that. I'm glad the Federalist Society and the Heritage Foundation got to him during the campaign and told him that courts were really important. The interesting test will be the second appointment, where the left, for all the reasons that Charles and others have remarked, are going to dig in. This is like Stalingrad to them. I have no confidence at the moment of what Mr. Trump is going to do in that circumstance. If he passes that test, I will lead the next inaugural parade in his honor.
Set up here first, and then we'll do you next. I'm sorry.
I found the discussion very interesting. I've got two questions, one to Mr. Caldwell and one to Mr. Kesler. Mr. Kesler, I'd like to remind you we're here to understand Trump and what he stands for. And we hear a lot of terminology, conservatism, constitutionalism, and republicanism. Can't be all those things, or can he be all those things? So I think we need to have some definition here of where the Republican Party stands in relation to Trump. The second question that for Mr. Caldwell, you raised an interesting point, and I'd like to have you elaborate what you meant by the fact that conservatism is an epistemological question. And that shows me that there's some question about the definition of what conservatism means. And that's why we're here. We're trying to learn what it means. Thank you.
Yeah. When I said the word epistemological, I was really only talking about the way voters who, unlike in other societies, are sovereign over their country, make sense of it. And, you know, it's the... Everyone needs a... The rulers of a country need a kind of an Archimedean fulcrum, you know. If you have that, you can move the world, right? But it has to be something that's standing still. All I was trying to say is that that the country needs to have a certain continuity in order for voters to feel that reality is standing still enough so that they can shape it, can read it, decipher it, decide on it, and shape it. That's all I meant. Now, I have said things about epistemology before, and I do find one interesting thing. One interesting aspect of the way different social classes perceive reality in today's economy is that we often forget that the new economy is a really new economy. It's not a streamlining of the old economy. These are new industries and new ways of doing things. People design software today and they eat, you know, several dozen different world cuisines for really cheap because there's a totally different labor market. So in a place like Washington, D.C., or Los Angeles, or Cambridge, you are in a place that is nothing like the economy was 30 years ago. And it's been populated totally by beneficiaries of the new economy. And I mean 100%. So when you're in a place like Cambridge, Massachusetts, you're with a bunch of really powerful people who work in the nonprofit sector and are connected to government and make a lot of money and have perfect health care, served by an equally large group of immigrants who are not making so much money, but who are so immeasurably better off than they were when they were back in Guatemala or Haiti or wherever they came from. So in this polity, you have a severe epistemological problem. You have people saying, well, what do I think of Donald Trump? You have a candidate who's saying, like, globalism stinks, we're getting screwed, it's terrible for America. Well, so you're like a professor of whatever at Harvard, and you think, well, is he right? Let me ask a cross section of my community. I'll ask, you know, but you look around though, and it seems like a real cross section, because in the world of 30 years ago, it would have been a cross section. You're asking your wife, you're asking men and women, you're asking really rich people, you're asking really poor people, you're asking old people and young people, you're asking black people and white people. What does your gardener from Haiti think of the global economy? He thinks it's great. So you've asked an incredible range of people and you feel you've got a scientifically rock solid answer. But you're in an epistemological bubble. I think that's the epistemological point, the main epistemological point I would make.
Yes. Go ahead.
No, go ahead, Charles.
No. Are you on this? Go ahead.
The first question, Charles? So yes, I think you should go first.
But this is, are you on the second? You're on this question.
Yeah.
So let Mark go.
Yeah, Mark. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you asked what does Donald Trump stand for? And we're trying to figure that out. If you ask the other side, they have no problem answering what he stands for. He is racism, he is sexism, he's nationalism. That's the left. If you ask the more moderate liberals, Donald Trump is a disruption in the flow of history, right? He's some kind of throwback or just this strange insertion in what was the course of progress. And I think we don't accept those characterizations, but I think we have to we have to account for those conceptions in our understanding of what Donald Trump stands for.
Let's come back to the first question. How can Donald Trump be, you know, an avatar of conservatism, republicanism, and every other ism? It's a very good question because as my colleague Mike Uhlmann has pointed out, we don't know much about his reading habits. And let's face it, he has not shown much interest in turning himself into an ism. He has not, Steve Bannon and other people around him may be interested in creating a Trumpism, and that is certainly true of many of our friends who wrote vigorously in defense of Trump during the campaign. We're looking to find the Trumpism in Trump. And there may be something there, but I don't think there's much evidence of it so far. I mean, not every politician, even ones that have great effects on the country, deserve an ism or want an ism. I mean, Obama really didn't have an ism. Carter didn't have an ism. Nixon didn't have an ism. Reagan did, sort of. Jackson did, Jacksonianism. There's no Coolidgeism. There's not even Wilsonism, although there's Wilsonianism, which is something slightly different.
I think Clinton had an asm.
Several.
Thank you very much, Elliot Geiser. I was a John Marshall Fellow in 2016. As a young 27-year-old American conservative, I've always felt like I've had to fight a two-front war, at least during my lifetime. One, defending a thin vision of the good classical liberalism, largely embodied in the federal constitution, and a thicker vision of the good, a more commonwealth model, and that the institutions of our government would be able to put those two things together, and that was what conservatism was, and that's what allowed the Reagan stool to persist as a definition so long. I'm wondering if Trump represents the thicker vision of the good rising to a much more national level, while liberalism has been abandoned predominantly by progressives. So in the era that Dr. Kesler talked about, it seems like there was always a countervailing force to Republican national protection from the Democrats, who wanted states' rights, who were against the tariff and wanted free silver. Without that countervailing measure, how effective or potentially destructive is a Republicanism bereft of its noble opposition?
That's a deep and interesting question. It seems to me like, conservatism has had for the past several generations, representatives of each, the thin and the thick, visions of the good or accounts of the good in it. I don't know that I don't know that we really know enough yet to say where Trump would fall in this, in the spectrum that you've outlined. But I do think that, to pick up on some points that Roger Pilon was referring to, I mean, federalism, of course, would be a convenient constitutional way out for a country that is very politically divided, and divided over both thin and thick questions. The problem is, the genius of the administrative state, the way modern national government has developed under liberal prodding for the past 100 years is extremely hostile to federalism. And it's very hard now to turn to federalism as relief or to federalism as a solution to the problem of fundamental disagreements in the country, because the project of liberalism for so long has been building a national political community in which all deficits, all feelings of lack, of need, of inferiority, of oppression are immediately nationalized and become, you can't have a local debate over transgender rights. That is a crusade that must be fought in every school district of the country from the top down, lest you violate some group, however small, some group rights claim. I don't see, I mean, that liberalism, which now in a way needs federalism more than it has in a while, has pulled a rug out from itself, I think. And I don't see an easy way back for them.
Michael Uhlmann raised the issue of the administrative state. And this, when we talk about priorities for the Trump administration, it seems to me that this needs to be somewhere near the top in terms of priorities. And one of the interesting things about the Obama administration that struck me is it was Nixonian without Nixon, which is to say that the administrative state is so highly developed anymore that when you have, say, like a grassroots movement like the Tea Party arises, Obama doesn't need to call turnspits at the IRS and say, hey, do something about this. It's a total hive mind. You know, the administrative state just rises up and takes care of the problem. And so there have been, you know, a lot of talk about this recently. I'm glad to see that, you know, actually thanks to Claremont's effort, the words administrative state are actually now being thrown around regularly in the political media. So that's encouraging. But there hasn't been a lot of talk about concrete solutions to this problem. Actually, in Walter Russell Mead's publication recently, I believe, there was a wonderful essay by Philip K. Howard about, you know, this actually is an area where, for instance, executive orders and executive actions may be appropriate for fixing the problem as opposed to having to rely on legislative issues. So my question is what do we do about this? Because it seems to me that, like, you know, fixing the administrative state is almost a pre-existing condition for fixing so many other problems that Trump needs to or wants to address.
Yeah. I have, it's a good
but
question.
But pre-existing conditions must be covered under the health care law.
I don't have a handy solution to this, and neither does anybody else. I have a set of instincts and prejudices. What's interesting about what Trump has proposed for regulatory reform, which is to have task forces in each department and agency draw up a list of priorities, do a rough kind of timetable for their elimination of those which are not necessary, and doing a cost-benefit analysis of those that remain on the books. There is a role for executive orders in this. What he did with the Title IX regulation was exactly the way to deal with that. There was a phony thing created by some deputy assistant secretary in the Civil Rights Office of the Education Department. That you can get rid of by executive order. The rest of the administrative state requires much more thoughtful, patient lawyers' work to take apart. And you can see one of the problems with this is they're trying to take apart Obamacare. That tumor has tendrils that go deeply into the rest of the body politic. You just can't do it by exec order to get rid of things. But fortunately, we have a lot of smart people out there who know how to do this. And if Trump is consistent with this, it can be done. But one of the things that struck me in looking at Trump's executive order on reg reform is that almost everything in it is something that Congress should be doing. And that's the dog that doesn't bark here. Here you have this anomaly of an overly powerful, you know, deep state executive, to use the buzz phrase, having to do the business of taking itself apart. It's like an erector set taking itself apart. Where is Congress? That's the question that has to be asked here. And one of the central planks of a revivified conservative movement is to get Congress back in the game of regulation. We're not going to shrink the size of the government radically until we do that. That's a very hard thing to do because it requires that Congress commit an unnatural act, the nature of which I cannot say in the public place. But it's the agenda item. That really has to be addressed. Otherwise, we're doomed.
Well, thank you all. That was a great panel. Thank you. So,